Stretch marks are a dermatologist's worst nightmare, not to mention a major source of frustration for patients. There are millions of people out there claiming to have a magic bullet for stretch marks, but most of them are totally wrong. The truth is, stretch marks are extremely hard to eliminate, but I'll go through some of the best known strategies to prevent stretch marks and to enhance or improve existing ones. In this video, we're going to discuss everything stretch marks. We'll talk about what they are, how we get them, how we prevent them, and most importantly, how we can treat or improve them. My name's Adam Aldehan, dermatologist and micrographic surgeon, and I've gone through all the evidence I could find about stretch marks, and I even have some personal experience with pregnancy. I guess not personally, but through my wife. So we've put our knowledge to the test, and we'll share with you everything we know. I hate stretch marks. Not that I have a personal vendetta against them, I just hate the way they affect patients' self-confidence. It can be really unsightly sometimes, and often patients' treatment journeys are extremely frustrating. Before we dive into that, we need to first understand what stretch marks are, starting with the basics. Stretch marks are linear streaks on the skin that occur in areas where the skin is rapidly stretched, hence the name. Our skin is comprised of layers. We have the epidermis on top. This is our major barrier against the elements. When our skin gets dry and flaky, it's layers of the epidermis that you see flaking out. Beneath that, we have the dermis. This layer is thicker and stronger. It holds our collagen and elastin in thick cords. Collagen gives strength and volume to our skin. Thousands of interlocking fibers make a mesh type of network in this area. Elastin is mixed in to give our skin stretchiness, and more importantly, helps our skin spring back after it's been stretched. It's elastic. Ooey, ooey, ooey. As our skin grows, it creates more collagen and elastin to maintain the support and integrity of our skin. Making collagen is a time-consuming process, so if our skin grows too fast for the collagen to keep up, the collagen becomes weak and can actually rip. When this happens, we initially get inflammation along the stretch mark because collagen gets angry at being ripped. This causes the reddish or the purple hue you see in early stretch marks. We call these striae rubra, which is the fancy term for red stretch marks. The color eventually fades over time into what we call striae alba, which translates to white stretch marks. To summarize, rapid stretching leads to tearing of the collagen, which leads to a permanent stretch mark. It's really that simple. Okay, but who gets them and when? Variations in our genetic code can dictate who is more likely to get them. Some people have naturally thicker collagen, some people don't. There are also some medicines and other hormonal factors that can weaken our skin and play a role in inducing stretch marks. For example, if you're on a systemic steroid, such as prednisone, you're more likely to have weakening of the skin, which can lead to stretch marks. These factors aside, stretch marks are usually seen in times of rapid growth. Examples include growth spurt, rapid weight gain, this can be fat or muscle, and very commonly, pregnancy. Wait a minute, we all start as babies, and we all grow into a much bigger human as an adult. Why does our skin not get stretch marks all over the place? The answer is simply speed. For the most part, our skin grows and stretches at a very slow rate, allowing the collagen plenty of time to keep up with its growth. Growth spurts are another story. Anyone who's shot up a foot over a year probably has stretch marks. It's all about how fast your skin stretches in a given time frame. Also, anyone who's done growth-enhancing stuff like growth hormone has a higher chance of developing stretch marks. For most people, stretch marks occur in the abdomen, thighs, upper arms, breasts. It can also happen in weightlifters who put on a lot of muscle. Usually this is seen in people who are on steroids. It's hard to naturally put on enough muscle mass to make stretch marks, but it's not impossible, especially if you're creatine loading, which can hydrate and add volume to our muscles. Pregnancy is another common trigger for stretch marks. It's because the belly stretches so fast in such a short period of time. Not all women get stretch marks. Why is that? Obviously, genetics plays a role to some degree, but did you know that you're actually more likely to get stretch marks if you get pregnant at a younger age than if you're older? The reason for this is the younger you are, the tighter and firmer your skin is, and the more resistant it is to stretching. This leads to a higher chance that the skin will actually tear when it stretches. As we get older, our skin gets a little bit more pliable, a little bit softer, and it can stretch farther before producing a stretch mark. A similar phenomenon occurs with your second or your third pregnancy. You're way less likely to get stretch marks after your first baby because your skin had already stretched once for the first baby, and now it has a little bit more give for the second one. Being a dermatologist, I'm pretty sure every pregnant woman I've ever met has asked me the same question. How do I prevent stretch marks? We'll get into that next, but before we do, remember to like the video and subscribe to our channel below. Okay, now on to the real deal. How do we prevent stretch marks? Is it even possible? For this section, we're going to focus on pregnancy-induced stretch marks. You can't really prevent your growth spurt, and fat or muscle gain for the most part can be controlled with our diet, so we'll stick to pregnancy. Fancy name for pregnancy-induced stretch marks is striae gravidarum. Gravidarum is Latin for pregnant woman. I can't tell you how many remedies I've seen to prevent stretch marks. There's always some obscure botanical in a fancy oil or cream, usually with a really high price tag. I have personal experience with pregnancy. Not me personally, but my wife, so close enough. So suffice it to say that we've done all the extensive research that nobody does. Even if you think you've done your homework, chances are you probably haven't researched the topic correctly. I don't mean that in a mean way. It's just really hard to actually get the answers even if you want to. The sad truth about scientific data is it's A, hard to search for, B, often restricted behind paywalls, and C, really difficult to interpret.
Show me the evidence.
There are hundreds of studies that look into stretch mark prevention during pregnancy. Some of the commonly used topicals include cocoa butter, vitamin E, and bitter almond oil. Before we can possibly know whether or not these actually work, it's important to know their proposed mechanisms, aka why they should work. If there isn't really a great scientific explanation, it's probably not going to perform well. Probably doesn't work. Cocoa butter is an easy write-off. Yes, it smells great. Actually, this is my favorite one. I'll leave a link in the description for anyone who wants a silky smooth texture and an incredible aroma. But it doesn't really have a reason why it should work for stretch marks. The best explanation is that it softens the skin and makes your skin a little bit easier to stretch. In my opinion, this doesn't make it any better than your typical moisturizer. Truth be told, I'm not buying it, and studies aren't buying it either. Cocoa butter has not been shown to be effective when used in pregnant women versus using nothing at all. Sorry, cocoa butter, you just don't work. Vitamin E and bitter almond oil are very similar in their proposed mechanisms. Bitter almond oil is actually very high in vitamin E, so for our purposes, we're just going to assume that vitamin E is the active ingredient. Vitamin E is an antioxidant that supposedly stimulates collagen production in the skin. Unfortunately, there isn't any great evidence out there to support this claim, and nothing out there that can actually quantify the collagen production, if any. The thing about vitamin E is it's not very stable the second it touches our skin. I think it does help a little bit as an antioxidant, repairing damage in the skin, probably similar to vitamin C, but to a lesser extent. But in reality, there's just not much to support its claims in real practice. The proof is in the pudding. When it comes to vitamin E and bitter almond oil, they simply don't prevent stretch marks when compared to control groups in studies. So what does work? Why do some products claim to work? Well, the truth is, some studies do show an improvement in stretch marks throughout pregnancy, but the reason might not be what you think. As we were knee-deep into our research, we began to see a trend. Some topicals seemed to work well in a few articles, but did nothing in other articles. Why was that? It wasn't consistent. We noticed that the studies who had positive results always used massage as part of their treatment regimen. We began to wonder if that could be the answer. Then we found it. There was actually an amazing study that addressed this directly. This article broke patients into three groups during pregnancy to see which group developed the fewest stretch marks. One group put almond oil on, but did not massage. A second group put almond oil on and massaged the oil into the skin for 15 minutes every other day. Final group did nothing. We call this a control group. The study found that those who did the almond oil alone with no massage had the same amount of stretch marks as those who did nothing. In other words, the almond oil by itself did nothing. However, in the group that massaged the almond oil into the skin, the amount of women who developed stretch marks decreased by half. Believe it or not, massage is actually the key intervention to prevent stretch marks. There are several studies who show other random products to have worked in preventing stretch marks. Each of these studies added massage to the regimen. Hence the confusion with all these products saying that they work. The product doesn't work, the massage does. It's literally all about the massage. Nothing else matters. We see similar improvements in thick or hypertrophic scars after surgery. The additional scar tissue tends to smooth out with 10 to 15 minutes of daily massage. Massaging actually helps remodel the collagen, aka working out the kinks. It's similar to muscle fibers that can form knots. The collagen in our skin actually gets arranged into these really complex bundles, and they can kind of get knotted up in a similar fashion. By remodeling and reorganizing the collagen in our skin, massage gives us the best chance of preventing stretch marks. And remember, the younger you are, the more likely you are to get stretch marks in pregnancy. So this message is especially for you. I'm trying to convince my wife to have a third kid so that we can test this on half of her belly. To my knowledge, a split face, or in this case, split belly study hasn't been done. If there is a study out there that exists, somebody please let me know in the comments so we don't accidentally scar my wife for life, literally. Moving on to treatment. Stretch marks are like acne. There are 1,000 remedies, but none of them work. Okay, that was an overstatement. But in reality, most things simply don't work to treat existing stretch marks. Stretch marks are permanent structures in our skin and actually contain scar tissue. So the goals of treatment of stretch marks are not to completely eliminate them, but rather blend them into the surrounding skin a little bit better. It's almost like a plate that you have that shatters. You can glue it back together, but you'll always see the seams. So keep in mind that when we talk about treating stretch marks, we're not talking about turning it into normal skin. That's not possible. And really all most people want is to improve the appearance anyways. Most people don't complain of pain or bleeding or irritation in their stretch marks, although it can happen. The vast majority of people with stretch marks just don't like the way they look. Now, before we get into the first treatment, it's important to know that I do not recommend using this during pregnancy. And I'm talking about topical retinoids. In general, we use very strong topical retinoids to treat existing stretch marks. Now, tretinoin is a pregnancy category C medication, meaning I do not recommend it in pregnancy. Did I already say that? I think I already said that. Never can be too careful. Gotta cover your butt. The idea behind tretinoin or other retinoids is that it can enhance collagen production in the skin. There are certainly some promising studies out there, but overall the evidence is still pretty weak. Or to rephrase that, maybe the evidence isn't weak, but the effect of the tretinoin is weak. As in, it might work a little bit, but it definitely doesn't work as much as most people want. And in case I haven't mentioned it, do not use retinoids in pregnancy. Didn't you mention that? I don't remember. Final treatment, and arguably the most effective, is lasers. For those of you who have stretch marks and want to know the treatment that actually works the best, lasers are probably your best bet. There are so many different lasers that have been shown to work to varying degrees. In my opinion, by which I mean based on my extensive research on the topic, fractionated lasers, either ablative or non-ablative, tend to work the best. We won't go into specifics in terms of laser types or settings, but this is the overall category that you're looking for. For these types of lasers, it's imperative that you find someone reputable, by which I mean a medical doctor, preferably a dermatologist. Dermatologists are specifically trained in laser science, settings of devices, and most importantly, complication management. The biggest thing that scares me about all these non-medically trained operators of lasers and dangerous equipment is that they don't know what to do when things go wrong. See a dermatologist if you can. I wouldn't mess around with fractionated lasers in amateur hands. In addition to lasers, there are other devices such as radio frequency that have shown some promise, although I think a fractionated laser in the right hands will get you the best results. Speaking of results, results definitely vary, and it's common to need two or three treatments. And lasers aren't cheap, so make sure you budget appropriately if this is what you want to pursue. Don't agree to any procedure until you fully understand the risks and expectations. It's all too common that people spend thousands of dollars for one treatment, and then they get frustrated when they realize they actually need two or three treatments and they weren't expecting. But keep in mind, cosmetic clinics are not in the business of refunds or returns. They're there to make money. So before you drop the big bucks, it's best to set your expectations and understand that everything's pretty much final sale. For those of you who are drawn to the cheapest option, this couldn't be more true in our field. You get what you pay for. In Cuba, they say, los baratos salen caro. I know. Hablo español. Which roughly translates to, cheap things become expensive in the end. If you found this information helpful, share with your friends. And don't forget to like and subscribe to our channel below. And as always, ask any and all questions you may have. We listen to our audience and tailor videos based on what the people want. Hope you enjoyed your coffee break.